So basically, n can equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. Now, if we know what the principal quantum number is of that electron, and we know what the energy is of the electron found in principal quantum number, is of the electron found within the nth principal quantum number. So basically, the first principal quantum number, the principal quantum number tells us the energy of our electron within the atom. Now let's move on to the second quantum number. The second quantum number is known as the azimuthal quantum number or the orbital quantum number. And the orbital quantum number is given by lowercase l. And the orbital quantum number is related to the angular momentum given by uppercase l of the electron within that atom. Now, what exactly is the meaning behind the orbital quantum number? So basically, the orbital quantum number describes the shape and the size of our orbit that we're dealing with. It describes the shape and the size of the electron cloud that is produced by that electron. Remember, the electron cloud basically gives us the most probable location of our electron within our atom. So it gives us the shape of the most probable location in which our electron is actually found around that atom. Now, what exactly are the values that the orbital quantum number can take? Well, L is readily given by this equation. So basically, if we know what the principal quantum number n is, we can determine the number of orbitals that our atom has. So L is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and all the way up to n minus 1, where once again n is the principal quantum number. For example, if we know that some given atom has 3 principal quantum numbers, so n is equal to 3, then that means by using this equation we see that our atom has 3 different orbital quantum numbers. So L can either be equal to 0, 1, or 2, where each one of these quantities represents its own shape and size and type of the orbital, the electron cloud that we are dealing with. For example, L equals 0 corresponds to a spherical electron cloud, a spherical orbit, as we'll discuss in a future lecture. Now, earlier we said that the orbital quantum number is related to something known as the angular momentum of our electron. Now, the relationship between the orbital quantum number L and the angular momentum given by uppercase L is given by this equation. So the angular momentum squared is equal to h bar squared multiplied by L multiplied by L plus 1, where L is the orbital quantum number, h bar is a constant that is related to Planck's constant, and L is the angular momentum. So we see a very important trend. Basically, the principal quantum number determines the number of orbitals we can have, the number of orbital quantum numbers that any atom can have. Now let's move on to the third quantum number we call the magnetic quantum number that is given by M with the L subscript on the bottom. Now if the shape, the size, and the type of our orbital, the electron cloud around the atom, is described by the orbital quantum number L, then the orientation and the direction of this orbital, the electron cloud in the three-dimensional space, is given by the magnetic quantum number. So basically, the orbital quantum number describes the type and the size and shape of our orbital, but the magnetic quantum number designates the orientation and direction of our orbital in the three-dimensional space. So the magnetic quantum number tells us the direction of the angular momentum, while the orbital quantum number describes the magnitude of our angular momentum. Now, what exactly are the values that the magnetic quantum number can take? So basically, this is the equation that tells us the different values that the magnetic quantum number can take. So in the same way that the principal quantum number determined the number of orbital quantum numbers, the orbital quantum number determines the number of magnetic quantum numbers. So ML is equal to negative L to positive L. So to see what that means, let's suppose that, for example, an electron is found within orbital L equals 1. So because we know what the orbital quantum number is, because L is equal to 1, we know that the possible magnetic quantum numbers are negative L, 0, and positive L. So basically, if L is equal to 2, then our ML can be negative 2, negative 1, 0, positive 1, and positive 2. So we see that for any given orbital quantum number L, there is a certain specific number, a certain limit to how many magnetic quantum numbers there are. That is, if we know what the orbital quantum number is, if we know what the shape of that orbital is, if we know what the shape of the electron cloud is, then we know there is a limit to the number of orientations that this orbital can take, this orbit can take within the three-dimensional space. So, for example, for L equals 1, there are three different orientations. And this is known as the space quantization of the magnetic quantum number. So basically, the fact that any given orbital has a certain number of orientations, has a limit to the number of orientations it can take, this is known as space quantization. And finally, the last and fourth quantum number is known as the spin quantum number, and this is given by M with the S subscript. Now, basically, any one electron within any given orbit can have one of two possible spin numbers. So any electron can have two possible spins. It can either have a spin up, in which case the MS is equal to positive 1/2, or it can have a spin down, in which it has an MS that is equal to negative 1/2. So let's examine the following example that deals with determining the angular momentum and energy of an electron within a hydrogen atom. So let's begin. Suppose we have an electron inside a hydrogen atom whose orbital quantum number L is equal to 5. So we want to determine what the angular momentum is in part A and what the energy is in part B of that electron, assuming that the energy of our electron is equal to 13.6 electron volts when our principal quantum number N is equal to 1. So let's begin with part A. So to calculate the angular momentum of the electron, we have to apply this equation. So the magnitude of the angular momentum L squared is equal to h bar squared multiplied by L plus 1, where lowercase l represents the orbital quantum number, and in this case, lowercase l is equal to 5. So let's isolate L on the left side by taking the square root of the left and right side. We get the following result. So L is equal to H bar, which is equal to 1.05 times 10 to negative 34 joules multiplied by seconds. And we multiply that by the square root of L, which is 5, multiplied by L plus 1, which is 6. So 30, we take the square root of 30 and multiply by H bar, and we get about 5.75 times 10 to negative 34 joules multiplied by seconds is the angular momentum of our electron within orbital quantum. quantum part B. To calculate what the energy is, we take our energy for principal quantum number n equals 1 and divide that by n squared. Now E1 is equal to 13.6 electron volts and n is equal to L minus 1. So we know that L is equal to 5 and 5 minus 1 is equal to 4. So we have 13.6 electron volts divided by 16 and that gives us about 0.85 electron volts. So this is the energy of that electron and this is the angular momentum of that electron when it's found inside the orbital quantum number L equals 5 inside the hydrogen atom. In this lecture, we're going to look at the selection rules that exist in quantum mechanics when electrons transition between energy states. So let's suppose we have an electron within some given atom, and that electron gains a certain quantity of energy in the form of a photon of light that has just the right frequency, so our electron jumps from a lower energy state to a higher energy state. Now, conversely, the opposite can also take place. So basically, if an electron transitions from a higher energy state to a lower energy state in the process, it will release a photon of light that has a certain given frequency, as shown in the following diagram. Now, in quantum mechanics, we know that certain electron transitions are more likely to take place than others. The ones that have a high probability of taking place, these transitions are known as the allowed transitions. And the transitions that are very improbable, the ones that are less likely to take place, are known as the forbidden transitions. And in quantum mechanics, a set of rules exist known as the selection rules that basically tell us which transitions are the allowed transitions. And these rules are given by these two rules. So, rule number one tells us that delta L, or the change in orbital quantum number during our transition, is either positive.